He was always bigger than life, the king of the sport of kings, Secretariat. The most famous thoroughbred of our time, maybe the best there ever was. His racing career spanned just 16 months from July of 1972 until near the end of October 1973. But his impact on the sport has transcended time. On 9 different racetracks, on dirt and grass, he made 21 starts with 16 firsts, 3 seconds, a third, and a fourth, with earnings of $1,316,808. It has been said by experienced horsemen that physically and mentally, Secretariat was the closest there has ever been to the perfect racehorse. The massive chestnut with 3 white stockings, a star, and a narrow strip stood 16 hands, 1.5 inches, and weighed over 1,100 pounds. His girth was so immense at 76 inches that he needed a custom-made saddle girth. Tests indicated his heart weighed from 14 to 17 pounds, the largest among any equine champions examined, and his stride measured an amazing 25 feet. In his 2-year career, he won 5 year-end Eclipse Awards. Champion 2-year-old colt, champion 3-year-old colt, champion turf horse, and horse of the year in 1972 and again in 1973. But his legendary status came not from titles nor track records, but from 3 races in the spring of 1973, when he became the sport's first Triple Crown winner in a quarter of a century. This, then, is his story as we take you from the beginning to the end of the life and times of Secretariat, an American racing legend. He came into the world at 12:10 a.m. on the cold, clear night of March 30th, 1970, at the Thoroughbred Farm in Dowswell, Virginia, known as The Meadow. The product of Ogden Phipps's great racehorse and leading sire, Bold Ruler, and the C.T. Chenery-owned mare, Something Royal. In a lifetime of chance, it was actually the loss of a coin toss between Ogden Phipps and Penny Tweedy in 1969 that gave The Meadow its miracle. The miracle came in the form of a colt with 3 white feet and a star and a stripe on the forehead. These were the first 5 names submitted to the Jockey Club, but not available for the colt. They wanted to name him Scepter, then Royal Line, or how about Something Special, or Games of Chance, or Deo Volente, Latin for God willing. All were rejected. Finally, the 6th name submitted was accepted. The name was Secretariat. Penny Tweedy had these early remembrances of Secretariat.
He was the boss of the herd. He was frisky. He was didn't hang around his mother, who was kind of an old lady by then, and he was very much in command from the time that I first saw him.
Secretariat's regular rider, Ron Turcotte, wasn't quite as impressed.
Well, I can be like a lot of people and say I knew right from the beginning, from the day I set sight on him. But I'd be lying to you, because there's so many great-looking horses that don't amount to very much. He was a great-looking animal, and was very manageable horses. You know, you could do anything with him. The only thing is that he didn't know which leg to put down first when the first time I worked him. I got beat some like 16th of a mile or better, going a quarter of a mile by, I don't recall the horse's name now. Anyway, he ran in the Derby the same year he was in front. But it didn't come around till about June before he started working real good. You know, you knew all the time he had quality, but he had to fill into it. And but when it comes to racing there, he had it all from the beginning.
Trainer Lucien Lauren remembers thinking the colt was just too good-looking to be a good racehorse. And it took an equipment change to turn Secretariat around.
I was working him, but he wouldn't go buy a horse. He wouldn't do hardly nothing. So I finally put blankers on him, and you wouldn't believe it. I took him to the gate, and with them blankers on, honest to God, he went 5/8 and 58 and 3. Even the clocker thought, oh, he says, have we got the right horse, Lucian? I says, I guess we have. So I was very tickled. So I worked him once more with a three-year-old, make sure that wasn't a fluke, you know. And that three-year-old was a pretty nice horse, and he even beat the three-year-old. So I called Mrs. Tweedy, and I says, we are ready, and we have a horse I think it can run.
Secretariat started for the first time in his career at Aqueduct Racetrack in New York, July 4th, 1972. He was the 3-1 favorite. At the break, Secretariat got sandwiched between Quebec and Big Bird, mugged in his first start. The colt recovered to make a big run and finish fourth. He would never finish that far back again. In his second start, again under jockey Paul Feliciano, Secretariat got off to another slow start, but then roared into the stretch and pulled away to win by 6 lengths. It was his first trip to the winner's circle. In a race for non-winners of two on Saratoga's opening day of 1972, Ron Turcotte took over the reins for the first time, and the big colt circled the field to win by a length and a half. He won his first stakes test, the Sanford, but it was in the hopeful that he really impressed his trainer and rider.
I don't think there's a three-year-old in the history that's ever run so fast from the half-mile pole to the quarter pole, or he went on in just galloping.
I've never been on a horse that runs that fast, that early, and keep going through the stretch.
Then I knew, I thought I had a good race for him.
He would go on to win 7 of his 9 starts at two, earn $456,404, winning at distances from 6 furlongs to 1 1/16, over fast tracks and muddy tracks. And he was voted 1972's Horse of the Year as a two-year-old, the first time in its 36-year history that the Daily Racing Form had ever honored a two-year-old as its Horse of the Year. As Secretariat was preparing for his three-year-old season in Florida at Hialeah Park, he had already set a world record, syndicated by Claiborne Farm into 32 shares, $190,000 per share, a total of $6,080,000. His 1973 debut came at Aqueduct in the Bay Shore. Secretariat won by 4.5 lengths. And then in his next start, the Gotham Stakes, he equaled the track record for the mile, winning by 3 lengths in 1:33 and 2. The Secretariat Express to the Kentucky Derby was derailed in his final prep race in New York, the Wood Memorial. Trainer Lucian Lauren had a two-horse entry, Secretariat and Angle Light. Angle Light led all the way and held off Sham to win by a head, with Secretariat, the victim of the slow pace, finishing third, 4 lengths back. Owner Penny Tweedy vividly remembers her reaction to the defeat.
Despair. What could have gone wrong? And just a lot of worry.
Turcotte talked about the reason for Secretariat's defeat in the Wood.
He wasn't right for the Wood Memorial. He had an abscess, and every time I try to pick him up, they throw his head and back up. And had I known before it, I would have turned his head loose and hope he'd go on from there. But I kept trying to ride him as usual, but he was too sensitive. And I didn't like his, the way he was handling himself. And then turning for home, Cordero kept carrying us out, which made me take a hole off him to the right rein again, and that stopped him from making that late run again. I would say the effect of the abscess took its toll in the Wood Memorial.
For Penny, the upset in that race before the Derby was like a release valve.
In a sense, it took pressure off because he was no longer unbeatable. Now he was just another candidate for the race. You never want to lose a race, but it did make it easier for us to have him be beaten before we went to Kentucky.
But there was no relief for trainer Lucian Lauren. Rumors ran rampant that Secretariat was not sound. He had bad knees. He didn't have the right breeding.
There was a lot of rumor around that the Boorooroo wouldn't go over a mile. Lucky, he just, like the rest of them, wouldn't go 1.8 miles, wouldn't do this, wouldn't do that. And Mrs. Tweedy, such a wonderful sport, she says, well, what do you think, Lucian? Well, I says, Mrs. Tweedy, I think he'll go 1.25 miles.
The painful abscess in Secretariat's mouth still hadn't broken when Turcotte flew down to Kentucky to work him for the first time at Churchill Downs.
I was not impressed at all with his work. Matter of fact, I was very disappointed. You know, he kept throwing his head the same thing. But that's when Sweat the groom told me that the abscess had broke and it should be better. But the next time I flew down to work him, there he was back to himself, and he just flew. And I was very confident then.
And the jockey remembers a meeting in Kentucky when the decision was being made whether or not Secretariat should even run in the Kentucky Derby.
Mr. Chenry, Mr. Lauren, and myself, and they wanted to know if I thought the horse could win the Derby, because he was syndicated for a lot of money, and if I didn't think he would win it, then he shouldn't run. And anyway, I told them that I was confident that he could outrun a horse going a mile, any horse going a mile, and all I had to do was gallop him the first quarter of a mile and, you know, let him take his time. So they told me, they said, well, you're the rider, and if you think you can win the race, we'll run him.
Good afternoon. This is Churchill Downs, Louisville, Kentucky, on this first Saturday in May 1973.
As Secretariat came on the track, his fans showed their support, making him the 3-2 favorite. But still, there were the doubts. Secretariat, number 1A, walked quietly into post position number 10 in this 13-horse field, and then into Derby history.
Moments from a start. They're at the post. All standing well as we wait for the start. Secretariat throws his head a bit. And they're off for the lead. On the inside, that's Angolite for the lead. On the outside, Checky Green, Royal and Regal. Then on the rail, it's Restless Jet, followed by Our Native. Up on the outside is Gold Bag. They're by the stands for the first time. Checky Green is showing the way by a length and a half. Royal and Regal now being moved to the inside, looking for room. Gold Bag is up on the outside. Then on the rail, it's Angolite, followed by Sham, Our Native, Restless Jet. It's My Gallant, then Forgo. On the outside, Navajo, followed by Secretariat, Warbucks, and finally, Twice a Prince. They're moving on the turn. The leader is Checky Green, leading by 2.5 lengths. Gold Bag is second by a head. Sham now third on the outside by 2 lengths. Royal and Regal fourth, 2 lengths then back to Angolite in fifth. The Secretariat has made a sudden move and is now sixth. Then it's Restless Jet, Our Native beginning to move up. Navajo, Forgo, and Warbucks beginning to move up, followed by My Gallant and Twice a Prince. They're into the turn and bunching for the lead with Checky Green, still the leader by a half a length. On the outside and challenging is Sham, and he's now got a head in front. Now Checky Green responds to the challenge, and those two are heads apart. Royal and Regal is third and holding on. Gold Bag drops back. Secretariat is fourth and moving up on the outside and is now third and moving at the leaders as they come for the head of the stretch. They're at the head of the stretch, and Sham is the leader. He leads it by a length. Secretariat is in the center of the racetrack and driving. Checky Green now drops back. Coming on a bit is Forgo, Our Native on the outside. Now and then the stretch, it's Secretariat. Secretariat on the outside to take the lead. Sham holding in second. It's Secretariat moving away. He has it by 2.5. Sham, then on the outside, Our Native. At the wire, it's going to be Secretariat. He wins it by 2 lengths. Sham is second. Our Native third by a neck. Forgo is fourth. Restless Jet is fifth. And it looked like Navajo might have gotten up for sixth.
He broke slowly, as he learned to do. You said he got mugged in his first race, and after that he just decided he was not going to contest those first few jumps, and he ran the race just exactly as we had planned it, and Ronnie never had to ask him to move. He seemed to understand what he was going to do.
They're into the turn and bunching for the lead with Checky Green, still the leader by a half a length. on the outside and challenging his Sham, and he's now got a head in front. Now Shecky Green responds to the challenge, and those two are heads apart. Royal and Regal is third and holding on. Goldbag drops back. Secretariat is fourth and moving up on the outside and is now third and moving at the leaders as they come for the head of the stretch. They're at the head of the stretch, and Sham is the leader. He leads it by a length. Secretariat is in the center of the racetrack and driving. Shecky Green now drops back. Coming on a bit is Forgo, our native on the outside. Now and there in the stretch, it's Secretariat. Secretariat on the outside to take the lead. Sham holding in second. It's Secretariat moving away. He has it by 2.5. Sham, then on the outside, our native. At the wire, it's going to be Secretariat. He wins it by 2 lengths.
Secretariat had answered all the questions, dispelled all the rumors, as he ran the first sub-2-minute derby in history, 1:59.2 for a new track record. As Secretariat celebrated in the winner's circle at Churchill Downs on that first Saturday in May, 1973, Penny Tweedy reflected on what her colt had learned from that defeat in the wood.
Secretariat was a very intelligent horse, and when he was beaten, he was angry. He was angry at himself. And after the wood, his head was in the corner of his stall, and I just had the feeling that he figured out, I'm not going to do that again. And the next time he came out and ran the race, he knew how to run, and he just walked his beat.
Old Hilltop, Pimlico Racecourse, Baltimore, Maryland, May 19, 1973, Preakness Day. The pressure was turned up on Secretariat's connections because it was at this site the year before that Meadow Stables' Riva Ridge lost his chance for the 1972 Triple Crown. Front-running winner of the Derby and the Belmont, Riva Ridge couldn't handle the sloppy track that day in the Preakness and finished a well-beaten fourth as the strong 1-5 favorite. As Secretariat, also the 1-5 fan's choice, was being dressed for the occasion in the Pimlico infield, he was forming his own race strategy that caught everyone by surprise, including owner Penny Tweedy.
As they came past the stands the first time, he was with horses. He wasn't way back. And suddenly he made a leap forward all on his own, as if, hey, I'm ready to go. And he just took off. And Ronnie hadn't asked him. It was not when we planned that he was going to move. He just decided to do it, and that just, I thought, okay, we've got this one.
Straightens up a little. Secretariat bobs his head. We're still looking, and they're off for the early lead. That's Deadly Dream on the outside, Ecole Tage. Then it's also Torsion on the outside. They're coming by us. It's Ecole Tage getting it, and he's still moving away by about 2.5 as they pass the stands. Settling into second, Torsion. Sham has good position, third on the rail. It's another 3 lengths back, Deadly Dream. Then our native and Secretariat is last again as they move into the first turn. They're into the turn. Ecole Tage has it by 2 lengths. Torsion second by a length, and then Sham third. Sham under an easy hold right now. But here comes Secretariat. He's moving fast, and he's going to the outside. He's going for the lead, and it's right now he's looking for it. Ronnie Turcotte sends him alongside Ecole Tage. Here we have it. Ecole Tage is the leader, but Secretariat is right alongside. Then still further back, that is Sham now going to the outside in third. We're moving down the backstretch. Secretariat holding it by a length and a half. Here comes Sham, second on the outside now. Now it's Secretariat, the leader, by a length and a half, with Sham moving into second. And it looks like Ecole Tage has had it, dropping back in third. Coming on in fourth is our native, and he's pretty close. Torsion, fifth, and a trailer way back is Deadly Dream. They're on the turn, and here's the race, folks. Secretariat trying to hold it, and Sham is driving to get him. These two are beginning to open a few lengths as our native settles into third, and he has about 3 lengths on Ecole Tage. Head of the stretch, Secretariat, 2.5. Sham under a strong left-handed whip, and he's making his run now, but it's still Secretariat holding on. Secretariat by 2 lengths. Sham driving second. There's a strong left-handed whip again by Tinkai. He goes to it time and time again, but Ronnie Turcotte has his whip put away, and Secretariat has him put away. He's beginning to draw away. It is Secretariat. He's coming to the wire. He wins it by 2.5, almost 3. Sham an easy second. Our native third. Ecole Tage for Deadly Dream fifth, and Torsion is sixth. And it was a powerhouse race again by the big, strong Secretariat, who made a very, very swift move on the backstretch, took the lead surprisingly.
The victory wasn't in question, just the time. The track teletimer said 1:55, a full second slower than the track record. But the Daily Racing Forum's chief clockers, from different vantage points, hand-timed the winner in 1:53.2. As Secretariat came into the winner's circle, word was spreading about the time discrepancy. It was a controversy that led to a special hearing before the Maryland Racing Commission, where CBS Television showed an identical frame-by-frame match of that 1973 Preakness on the bottom and track record holder Canonero II's 1971 Preakness on the top of the screen. The results? Secretariat was almost two lengths faster than the old 1:54 record time. But despite the overwhelming proof, Maryland racing officials would only agree to clocker E.T. McLean Jr.'s hand timing of 1:54 2/5 seconds for the race. But the Daily Racing Forum, on its official chart of that 1973 Preakness, noted forever its disagreement, adding their own footnote. Daily Racing Forum time, 1:53 2/5 seconds. New track record. Ron Turcotte reflects back on Secretariat's effort in the Preakness.
Secretariat was always the kind of horse that loved to run around turns. He was a lefty. You know, that means he led with his left foot all the time, and he flew around turns. When we came around the first turn, passing the wire the first time around, I started to draw behind them horses, and I looked up ahead, and I seen they all folded up on their horse. They were backing down a little bit, so I just swung them out so I wouldn't get trapped in the inside. But he just breezed by them and went by everybody around the first turn, took the lead around the three-quarter pole, and the rest was history. Shane was trying to catch him. Lafitte was whipping to beat hell, and I kept hearing him there. I hated to be that horse. Gee, that poor Shane. He must have got a beating there. Anyway, he won with something in reserve. I kept thinking the Belmont and, you know, have something in reserve. I didn't want to use him up.
In the 3 weeks between the Preakness and the Belmont, Secretariat transcended sports and became a national phenomenon. He appeared on the covers in the same week of Time, Newsweek, and Sports Illustrated. Penny Tweedy remembers all the attention and all the pressure.
It just was every day, one more day until race day. I had no idea whether or not he could do it, but I knew that he would be as fit as Lucien could possibly make him, and that he had grown intellectually, and he was mentally much more professional an athlete than he had been earlier, say, in the wood. And so I felt that everything was right for it, but we had still to do it.
But Ron Turcotte and Lucien Lauren never had any doubts he would do it.
We had won the Belmont with River Ridge the year before, and he worked about two full seconds faster for the mile for the Belmont that River Ridge had done, and we were very, very confident. I mean, matter of fact, I told Mr. Lauren when we went out for dinner that night, when we had a few drinks, maybe we were probably a little overconfident then, and the competition wasn't there, you know, when you're having the drink there. But I told Mr. Lauren, I said, if this horse gets beat, I'm going to hang up my tack. And Mr. Lauren said the same thing. He said, I'm going to quit training if this horse gets beat. That is our confidence we were of the race.
Horse, and we're ready to go for this tremendous Belmont Stakes. Everybody's in line, and they're off. Looks like the early lead goes to Mike Gallant. Yes, Mike Gallant going for the lead with Price to Prince on the outside. Secretariat away very well, has good position on the rail, and in fact is now going up with the leader. They're moving for the first turn. It is Secretariat. Sham on the outside is also moving along strongly. And now it's Sham. Sham and Secretariat are right together into the first turn. Mike Gallant has third behind them. Then it's Price to Prince, and the trailer is Private Smiles as they go by the turn. Those two together, Sham on the outside. Sham getting ahead in front as they move around the turn with Secretariat second. Then there's a large gap. Make it eight lengths back to Mike Gallant in third and Vice of Prince fourth. And Private Smiles is still the trailer. They're on the backstretch. It's almost a match race now. Secretariat's on the inside by a head. Sham is on the outside. They've opened 10 lengths on Mike Gallant, who is third by a head, with Vice of Prince fourth. Then it's another eight lengths back to Private Smiles, who is trailing the field. They continue down the backstretch, and that's Secretariat now taking the lead. He's got it by about a length and a half. still stands. 10 lengths back, My Gallant Twice a Prince. They're moving on the turn now. For the turn at Secretariat, it looks like he's opening. The lead is increasing. Make it 3, 3.5. He's moving into the turn. Secretariat holding on to a large lead. Jam is second, and then it's a long way back to My Gallant and Twice a Prince. They're on the turn. It's Secretariat is blazing along the first 3/4 of a mile in 109 4/5. Secretariat is widening now. He is moving like a tremendous machine. Secretariat by 12. Secretariat by 14 lengths on the turn. Jam is dropping back. It looks like they'll catch him today as My Gallant and Twice a Prince are both coming up to him now. But Secretariat is all alone. He's out there almost a 16th of a mile away from the rest of the horses. Secretariat is in a position that seems impossible to catch. He's into the stretch. Secretariat leads his field by 18 lengths. And now Twice a Prince has taken second, and My Gallant has moved back to third. They're in the stretch. Secretariat has opened a 22-length lead. He is going to be the Triple Crown winner. Here comes Secretariat to the wire. An unbelievable, an amazing performance. He hits the finish 25 lengths in front. It's going to be Twice a Prince second, My Gallant third, Private Smiles fourth, and Sham, who had it today, drops back to fifth. An amazing, unbelievable performance by this miracle horse. And look at...
Everyone has their own special memories of what is still described today as the greatest thoroughbred race in modern history.
We broke very good at leaving the gate there, and... The only concern I was there is not falling off even the gate, because the last two Triple Crown winner had stumbled badly even the gate, Assault and Citation. And Mr. Lauren had a dream that I fell off even the gate, so he kind of put that in the back of my head. But we left very good, and heading into the first turn, I was on the inside. I didn't want to get shut off, shuffle back where I have to take a hold of him, so I just let him ease up in the inside. And he took the lead for a brief moment, and then Sham collared him. Took us around the turn till he, I don't know if he broke down or what happened to him, but anyway, he had it. He called it the day by the 7-8 pole, and Secretariat just galloped the rest of the way.
Penny Tweedy remembers being concerned early in the race about Secretariat's main rival, Sham, who had finished second, beaten just 2.5 lengths in both the Derby and the Preakness.
I was afraid when Sham went with him that this was going to be the time that Sham was going to get his revenge. And a little part of me said, go for it, Sham, because I had great respect for Sham and felt really sorry that he happened to have raced the same year as Secretariat, because he was a wonderful horse. But then Sham did draw back, and then I was just in awe. I couldn't believe that he was just going on. And I keep hearing in my mind Chick Anderson's call, Secretariat is moving like a tremendous machine. He's out there all alone.
Secretariat is widening now. He is moving like a tremendous machine. Secretariat by 12. Secretariat by 14 lengths on the turn. Sham is dropping back. It looks like they'll catch him today as My Gallant and Twice a Prince are both coming up to him now. But Secretariat is all alone.
Lucian and I were side by side, and suddenly Lucian said, oh my God, Ronnie, just don't fall off. Don't fall off. Don't fall off.
When you're out alone like that, you keep, you know, you hear the crowd, the announcer, and I kept hearing him saying 15 lengths, 20 lengths, and finally the 316 pole, I just looked back there and said, hey, am I really that far in front? Naturally, I couldn't hear anybody, you know, and he was, and when I got by the 8th pole, I said, pal, just don't fall down now.
Officially, it was 31 lengths. Secretariat had just smashed the world record for 1.5 miles on the dirt by 2 1/5 seconds. The new standard was 2:24 flat. Lucian Lauren vividly remembers looking at that teletimer with those incredible world record fractions.
I kept looking every time. I thought the thing was broke. It was impossible to run that fast when you went the first 3/4 in 9 4. It says to Mrs. Tweedy at the time, I says, Jesus, God almighty. How's he going to last? He's only halfway and he's going that fast. He's nowhere in the world. And then to run 1 1/34 in 3, 1 mile he ran a mile and a quarter and 159 flat, which that would have been the record if, you know, if he would have gone that far. Nobody never broke it yet, and never come close to it. And then, as you know, he went the mile and a half, and they claimed that he went the last quarter in 24 and 4 or something like that, going a mile and a half. It's unbelievable. I said to her when he comes at the head of the stretch, I says, I just hope he gallops him the rest of the way. And you know, Ronnie made a statement, he says that he was running easy. It's unbelievable, isn't it?
Unbelievable it was. Horses are not supposed to be able to run like that. Look at Secretariat's times for each furlong, or eighth of a mile, in that mile and a half Belmont race. None were slower than 12 and 4/5 seconds. Even with Turcotte standing up as he crossed under the wire, Secretariat's momentum, galloping out an extra eighth of a mile, unofficially eclipsed another record. According to Charles Hatton of the Daily Racing Form, Secretariat pulled up the mile and five furlongs in 2:37 and 2/5, which would have shattered that world record held by Swaps by 4/5 of a second. He was racing's ninth Triple Crown winner, but the first in a quarter of a century since Citation swept the classics in 1948. Secretariat certainly didn't rest on his Triple Crown laurels. He went to Chicago and won the Arlington Invitational by 9 lengths, but then was upset in the Whitney at Saratoga by Onion when Secretariat was running at less than 100% after battling a low-grade fever. Next was the race made especially for the Triple Crown winner, the $250,000 Marlboro Cup. It was Meadow Stables' two champions, Riva Ridge and Secretariat, going head-to-head for the only time in their careers. And it was another trying moment for the entry's owner, Penny Tweedy.
The Marlboro was one of the hardest races for us because I love both horses. And I wanted them to finish about the way they did, but I didn't want Riva to be embarrassed. And I knew that Secretariat was really a stronger and more talented horse.
The champion had bounced back and set a new world record for the mile and an eighth, 145 and 2. After a loss in the Woodward to Prove Out, Secretariat made his debut on the turf with a course record clocking of 224 and 4 in the mile and a half man of war.
Holding on to the lead by two lengths.
I have great faith in Lucian, and he's a master horseman. And if Lucian told me something really could be done, I tended to believe it, and he was very rarely wrong. And Lucian really believed in me. He said that he was going to run better on grass than he had on dirt, and only had two races, but I think he would have proved to be an even better horse on grass.
Secretariat's racing career came to a close at Woodbine at the Canadian International Championship. Penny remembers his performance was much better than the weather that October 28, 1973, in Ontario.
There was fog, it was sleeting, it was cold, and you could hardly see the race. All I remember, and Ronnie had been set down. He'd been suspended for careless riding, so he couldn't ride him in his final race. And Eddie Maple rode him, and Eddie is a friend, and he was just ashen. He was just white with fear that he would foul up in Secretariat's last race. But he didn't, and he came sweeping home out of that gloom, and it was just with tremendous relief.
You could run him on anything, you know. You could run him on the dirt. He ran in the mud, he win. He ran on a fast track. Run him on the grass, he win. In his last race, I was very, very nervous in Toronto because it rained all day. It was really deep, and I was worried, you know. I says, oh, my God, he never run on a deep, you know, grass races. And I figure, well, I hope he doesn't slip. You know, sometimes in the grass, when it's wet, it slips. But he ran a beautiful race, as you know. I just think he was the greatest of all horses, bar none.
On November 6, 1973, Secretariat took his final curtain call, where his racing career began at Aqueduct Racetrack in New York. Nearly 33,000 fans turned out on a non-racing day just to say goodbye to the champion.
I was unprepared for how badly I'd feel. I've seen the film of it, and I was on the edge of tears. Other people were crying. 6,000 people came out just to see him gallop up and down the stand, the stretch there, and he felt that he hadn't done his job. He went out and he warmed up and he came back, and then, what's the matter? Aren't I going to run? Why am I being taken back? And he kind of fought Eddie. It was a hard day, but it was a heartwarming day because so many people came out to just say a personal goodbye to him.
On November 11th, Secretariat was flown to Claiborne Farm to begin his career as a stallion. And Penny remembers the emotions of that plane ride to Kentucky.
That was sad. We just tried. I guess I only took the plane ride because I was trying to make it not end. The Claiborne people took him right from the plane, put him in their vans, and off he went. And it was just terribly hard.
As a stallion, he was expected to do the impossible, reproduce himself. Despite these unrealistic expectations, Secretariat still left his mark. He sired the first yearling ever to sell for $1 million, sired more than 40 stakes winners, including the 1986 Horse of the Year, his daughter, Lady's Secret, and the 1988 Preakness and Belmont Classics winner, Risen Star. Secretariat remained a celebrity long after he left the racetrack. He remained the most talked about and most photographed thoroughbred in the world. On Labor Day 1989, Secretariat was diagnosed as having laminitis. Dr. William Reed of the American College of Veterinary Surgeons.
Laminitis actually is a degeneration and inflammation in the foot itself. In the early stages, it is curable with adequate treatment. However, it's impossible to determine all stages of laminitis. In other words, it's referring to Secretariat, it's impossible to determine exactly when the early stage was. Some horses are a little bit sore-footed, particularly older horses, older stallions, for example. They have a lot of weight bearing, and some of them don't take quite as much exercise as they did earlier on, and consequently, they're prone to laminitis.
On October 4th, 1989, at 11:45 a.m. Eastern Time at Claiborne Farm in Paris, Kentucky, the great champion had his life humanely ended, euthanized to prevent further suffering from an incurable condition. At age 19, Secretariat was gone. Buried in the same cemetery at Claiborne as his father, Bold Ruler, and other legends of the turf. At Belmont Park in New York, a special wreath was placed in front of the bronze statue in the paddock to mark his passing. And those that were closest to him reflected on his greatness and on the impact this amazing thoroughbred had on their lives and the lives of so many.
Secretariat, I didn't never really had anything to do with him. All I did was went along for the ride. You know, he was the most horse. He was so great. He'd done everything himself. So I take no credit for what Secretariat has done. But like I said, I grew close to them because I was in every one of their workouts, and I love them. You know, there's many riders that doesn't have the same recognition I have that has won more races, and I've won a lot of races before that in Class 6, but I'm known for the boy that rode Secretariat, and that's not a bad thing to be known for.
His groom, Eddie Sweat, knows that the Big Red Horse made him famous, too.
I would say thank you, Big Red, for all the things that you have done for me and for the public of people.
And will there ever be one as good as Secretariat?
Not in my time. I'll guarantee you, not in my time. Maybe he said that you always find one. It took quite a while. That's about, what, a half a century, 50 years from an award to him. So I don't know if it's going to take that long to get the next one.
Penny Tweedy knew that she had to share his loss, just as she had had to share his life.
People all over the world are missing the horse that represented a wonderful dream, a dream of success and accomplishment on sunny days and muddy tracks. Just something special is gone.
There have been other thoroughbreds that have won more races, more money, and more championships, that have even won a Triple Crown. But none had the impact of Secretariat. He came along just when we all needed him the most. 1973 was a difficult year. The time of Nixon and Watergate and the Vietnam War. The country needed a hero. And here was this red horse in blue and white silks. A red, white, and blue hero for America. We honor our heroes with monuments. And so it is fitting that the spirit of this champion thoroughbred be enshrined forever in this bronze statue in the paddock at Belmont Park in New York. Still setting the standard by which all great race horses of today and tomorrow are measured. When the statue was unveiled, prominent horseman Paul Mellon said, "Secretariat belongs to history, to the romance of the turf, and he belongs to the people." As a tribute to Secretariat, we present this special music essay. The song is by Richard Marx, "Right Here Waiting for You." For a quarter of a century, thoroughbred racing had waited for a racehorse like Secretariat.
Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you. Whatever it takes, or how my heart breaks, I will be right here waiting for you. I took for granted all the time that I thought would last somehow. I hear the laughter, I taste the tears, but I can't get near you now. Oh, can't you see it, baby? You've got me going crazy. Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you. Whatever it takes, or how my heart breaks, I will be right here waiting for you. I wonder how we can survive this romance. But in the end, if I'm with you, I'll take.
Like a tremendous machine. The Secretariat is all alone. He's out there almost a 16th of a mile away from the rest of the horses. Secretariat has opened a 22-length lead. He is going to be the Triple Crown winner.
Oh, can't you see it, baby? You've got me going crazy.